Hi everyone and welcome to this video. For today, here in front of me, I have a Dell OptiPlex 7040 Micro. In this video, we will start by taking a good look at this lovely micro form factor PC. After getting to know the device, we'll take it apart and reassemble it while performing some upgrades. Finally, I will also test the performance of this small PC to check if size does matter. The OptiPlex 7040 Micro or Mini was introduced somewhere end of 2015. It was part of a broader lineup, the 5th generation OptiPlex, which also had a small form factor and micro tower PC. All of these came with 6th generation Intel Core CPUs and DDR4 memory. At release, they were distributed with Windows 7 and later with Windows 10. As you can see from the Dell website at the time, it was clearly targeted towards business users as the rest of the OptiPlex series PCs. As mentioned at the beginning, let us start by having a better look at a device. Since this is a micro form factor PC, as the name suggests, it's pretty small, yet surprisingly complete with quite the connectivity options like USB 3, multiple video outs, wired and wireless networking. The device is more or less square and about 18 cm wide, around 17.5 deep, and about 4 cm high, similar to a Mac Mini at first glance. At the front, we can find a power button, microphone in, line out, and two USB 3 ports. At the back, we have the Wi-Fi antenna, Ethernet, 4 more USB 3 ports, an expansion port, display port, HDMI, and the power input. That power is supplied with an adapter, similar to what typically would come with a laptop. This model requires a 65-watt adapter that delivers 19.5 volt. The size of the adapter is reasonable in comparison with the device itself. Other than that, on the outside, there isn't much more to see. Design-wise, it's sober but gives a decent impression. Time to see what is inside. You can easily open up the device without any tools and, as you will see through the video, that goes for most of the hardware-related actions on this PC. All we need to do to open up the enclosure is to loosen the center thumb screw and then slide the top part forward. First thing that catches my eye is that there is no SATA drive installed, but the blue plastic bracket is fortunately still there. I guess it's not very easy to get one of these if it would be missing. We can also see the CPU fan unit, and below that, although hard to see on the video, I can spot a single DDR4 SODEM. After we remove the SATA disk bracket, we can see that there is a wireless and Bluetooth M.2 card installed, and to my surprise, the other M.2 slot has a half-length SSD. That doesn't really look like something Dell supplied. The numbers on the sticker suggest that this is only a 32GB SSD. Probably not even NVMe, but SATA. As I'm curious to see what operating system is on there and what this device was used for in the past, let me stop the disassembly here and first power on this box to see what is still on there. Ha, that looks familiar, VMware ESXi. For people that don't know what this is, ESXi is a hypervisor for virtualization. It allows you to run virtual machines on top of this hardware, allowing this PC to run multiple virtual PCs. It makes sense to have this on a 32GB SSD, as it is basically only needed to start up the hypervisor and then to keep logs. The virtual machines itself would probably reside somewhere else on a network chair. But still, the rest of the hardware, especially with only 8GB of RAM which is in there, isn't really a good match for running virtual machines. Pretty strange. Once ESXi fully booted, I tried a few common or default passwords like admin, root, password, password 123, and so on, but neither of these allowed me to get in. At least we get to see the CPU model, a Core i5-6500T, and the amount of memory currently installed. While we're at it, let's have a quick look at the BIOS setup as well before we continue. F2 is the key you need to press to enter this. System information shows us what we partly already knew. 8GB of RAM in a single DIMM of DDR4, an Intel Core i5-6500T with 4 cores, and indeed a SATA drive in that M.2 slot. The rest of the BIOS setup is pretty standard for a Dell machine, but as is usually the case, with plenty of options to tune or change settings. Back to the hardware. Now that we know a bit more about what is in there, I decided to upgrade the memory with an additional 8GB for a total of 16GB and to install a SATA SSD of 500GB. Replacing that M.2 SATA SSD with a decent NVMe drive would give better performance, but this is what I had laying around and it performs decent enough. Time to start our disassembly, properly this time. First, I'll get that blue drive bracket out again. And then we can remove the fan assembly by pinching on the sides. There are two connectors here, one for the fan, the second for the speaker. This also gives us access to the memory, and we can get that single 8GB DDR4 SODIMM out. The M.2 SATA drive now, which is only 32GB as we saw. And in the second M.2 slot, we have our Wi-Fi and Bluetooth card. After carefully disconnecting the tiny antenna connectors, we can get that card out as well. Next up is the CPU heatsink. Although I loosened the screws properly, the heatsink doesn't seem to come off easily. Let me try to remove this black plastic piece, although it doesn't seem related. Yeah, that didn't help, so I guess some more force is required. There we go. Crusty thermal paste is the explanation on why this was difficult. That looks better if you ask me. Let's get the CPU out as well now. An i5-6500T, as we could see earlier in ESXi and the BIOS setup. The T version is a low power version. If we compare it with the regular i5-6500, we can see a lower clock speed and almost half of the TDP for the T version. Probably this will also perform a bit slower, but we'll get back to that in the benchmarks. All components are out. Let's unscrew the motherboard. And get it out of the small case. On the motherboard, we can find a CPU socket, two DDR4 SODIMM memory slots and two M.2 slots, a single SATA port, the CMOS battery and password reset jumper, CPU fan and speaker connector, and connectors for that optional port which you had at the back. Cool to see such a small motherboard, which is still pretty complete. Basically, all you need is present. Here we have all components laid out nicely on the table. We got the motherboard, CPU, 2x8GB of RAM, new SSD, drive bracket, CPU fan assembly, M.2 SSD, Wi-Fi card, and the bottom and top case. Time to put things back together, so we're just going in reverse order. First, I'll put back the motherboard and get it fixed. Then I can put back the CPU in the socket. Just need to pay attention for the orientation indicated by this corner. Insert the CPU and close the socket. A bit of fresh thermal paste, which was pretty much needed, and we are good to put back the CPU heatsink and fix that one as well. Now I can put in the two memory modules. And after reconnecting the CPU, fan and speaker, we can just click the fan assembly back in its place. Next up is the Wi-Fi and Bluetooth card. Putting it back in the M.2 slot is easy. Connecting the antennas is a bit less easy. There we go. We're good to fix this together with that small plastic cover. I will also put back that M.2 SATA SSD. I'm not sure what I will do with it, but I figured that I can as well put it in there. The new 2.5-inch SATA SSD goes first in the blue plastic bracket, again without any tools. And then slides right in there where it should be. That was it. Pretty straightforward and fast. We're good to close up the case. Let's have a look and see if the reassembly and upgrade was a success now. In system information, we can already see the additional 8 GB of memory, and the 2.5-inch SATA SSD also shows up here. Let me change the boot sequence to the new 500 GB SSD. And if all goes well, Windows 11 should boot from that drive. Nice. Let's have a look at About in Windows. No surprises here, just a confirmation that all hardware is properly detected as we expect. Time for some benchmarks now. I'll start with Geekbench 5, not the newest, but I have a lot of previous tests to compare the results with. $2,733, not bad at all for such a tiny machine. If we compare this result with two earlier tested i5-6500s, which had the non-T version, we can indeed see that there is a difference in performance. After all, the CPU in this Dell OptiPlex Micro uses about half the power as a regular version, so that shouldn't be a surprise. Now, let's see what the new Geekbench 6 tells us. $3,025, pretty much in line with the expectations as well. The next test is disk performance. I'm really curious to see how that M.2 SATA SSD will perform. Something tells me it won't be as great as you expect from your average M.2 slot drive. Since ESXi is still installed here, let me first clean up those partitions. There is no easy way to reset the root password if it's lost, and most likely the actual virtual machines were not on the small M.2 drive anyway. After cleaning up, I'll create a new NTFS volume so we can use this device in Windows. Let's launch AGS system test now and see first how the new SSD which we added performs. Around 460 MB per second write and 500 read. More or less what you can expect from a SATA SSD. Time for that M.2 drive now. Ouch, that's a lot lower than I expected, and my expectations were already low to begin with. Looks like we get the write speed of only around 35 to 40 MB per second. Reading does go faster, but not even close to that regular 2.5-inch SATA SSD which we have in here now. I guess this was fine for its use case with the SXi, but I'm not sure what I will do with it in the future. As a last test, let me connect to Wi-Fi and check out how that performs. I will copy a large test file over the network and see which speed we are getting. Around 20 to 22 megabytes per second. Let's say around 180 megabit per second. That's not great. While coverage is fine and devices that are nearby, like my phone, can easily get more than the double. To show you that this is not something with the network share itself, and also to test performance of the wired network port, let me repeat this test with the cable connected. A solid 112-113 megabyte per second, the maximum of that gigabit connection. So we can conclude that wired works as expected, but Wi-Fi is not the best in here. That was it for the video. The OptiPlex 7040 Micro is a small but powerful machine, as we could see. Despite its age and size, it is still doing a very good job and looks like a perfect PC for day-to-day use, like browsing the web, watching streams or videos, and some basic editing work. Working on this PC hardware is a real pleasure. Everything is easily accessible and Dell did a really good job in terms of serviceability here. Thanks a lot for watching. I hope you have enjoyed this, and as always, if you have liked this video, a thumbs up is welcome. Feel free to subscribe to my channel and let me know in the comments what you think about this machine. Thanks again and hope to see you back here soon.